Hello and welcome to Nintendo Podcast Systems with me, Sam Spade. Joining me as always is Mr. Matthew Gibson.
Hello.
And we have a special guest here, it's Ian Hannam.
Hannam, but hello.
Damn it! And I still fluffed it up, even after asking for Ian how does it pronounce his surname. But there you go, that's life. Cool, Ian, where do you hail from?
So I'm from Southampton in the UK.
Woo!
Yeah,
best place to be.
One shout out there, yeah. Pretty good. But yeah, pretty near to the New Forest as well. So yeah, got a bit of everything down here.
Sweet, sweet. And what do you do in the world of Nintendo or gaming, shall I say?
Yeah, well, I'm pretty firmly in the Nintendo camp, to be honest. Have been for quite some time. So, yeah, 3DS at the moment and Wii U, of course, and very much looking forward to the Switch.
Sweet.
Well, it's great to have you on, you know. We had all of... Was it two episodes ago? We had all of Nintendo Voice come on.
Yeah, that was funny.
that was a good episode, yeah. Like, the Nintendo Voice guys are just so cool. And you are too, so I'm really happy that you managed to make it tonight.
Thank you for the warm welcome.
Yeah, right. We are missing one person, aren't we, Mr. Gibson?
Why, yes. Jack Gorn, who...
Sadly, he's got a very busy schedule, yeah. Shall we say, and just can't make it
basically
this time round.
Yeah, and I think I'd be all out next week because I have a lot of work to do next week. So it's like, it's better to do one episode in 2 weeks' time rather than just the episode in 2 weeks' time. But yeah, Ian, as our guest, you were able to choose the opening music, so what track did you choose?
Well, I went for a tune from one of my kind of favourite old SNES games. That was pretty iconic and a really great game. Just thoroughly enjoyed that one.
Personally, I've not played it, but I have heard that theme is really good. And see, everybody at home, you've just heard it, so it is a very good tune.
Yeah, I think I still need to listen in then. I still need to play Chrono Trigger, actually.
It's a very good title.
Really?
It's very well renowned within the Nintendo library of games.
Yeah.
I know it was released some years ago again on the DS, and I think it involved quite a few video cutscenes and things like that, and
it was
looking like
a
pretty good version.
All right. Yeah, I think Jack was talking about it like a good while back on the show.
He did, yeah.
Right, so that's it for our intro. I hope you enjoyed this episode, and let's go straight into the news section. And this is the news, which is always the first section, and depending on your taste, it could be the best section. So, starting us off, we have a release date for Shantae Half-Genie Hero, and it is coming on December 20th.
That'll be a digital release.
Yes.
So that'll be off the eShop, which I know I've got my eye on as soon as it comes out.
Yeah, it looks really good. I'm really happy that this came out just before the end of 2016, so it may be able to make my... top 10 of 2016 list, Nintendo wise at least.
Well, for me, luckily it comes 2 days after payday, so I'm just like, oh, lovely, I can get that, and that'd be a nice Christmas thing to keep me busy.
Nice.
And episode thing for the channel, so
yep.
I can't wait. I've waited so long and I've been so patient.
Yeah. Did you back the Kickstarter at all?
I didn't. No.
All right.
Nope.
All right. And another game that Sam, you're most likely looking forward to, especially as it's your avatar, is Shovel Knight: Spectre of Torment.
Oh yes, they showed that off at the Game Awards.
Yeah.
Oh my God! Just from that, I'm extremely hyped. As soon as I played through Shovel Knight, I'm like, yep. It's my favorite character. As much as all of them are absolutely amazing, and they got their charm and stuff. I don't know why Spectre Knight had something like almost hidden It's like, I want to know more about this character.
I guess so.
And this will show him off in a brilliant way. And apparently, I've also learned, this is a little tidbit I've picked up. I can't remember where I read it, but you, instead of having to play like set amount of levels as they unveil the map, you can actually play the levels in whatever order
that,
you want. So this is going to be interesting.
Very interesting.
I'm even more hyped for it now. I can't wait till they actually announce when it will be released.
It's a pretty good time to be a 2D platformer fan, isn't it?
Oh, really? Yeah.
I hail from the 2D platform time. I'm that old. But yeah, it is a good nostalgia game. But on its own, for the newcomers, it's, again, a brilliant game. And they also showed off Breath of the Wilds as well.
Hmm. Oh, so... Yeah, so with Breath of the Wild, you got a demo from Bill Trinan and Nate Bildoff from Nintendo of America's Treehouse. Mm. But what I think was more impressive was the Ruins trailer, Life in the Ruins.
Mm.
So what it showed basically was just a brief glimpse of just other civilization. I think some were taking down some monsters, some were just arriving to village, and then you got a look at quite a big town, which reminded me of Kakariko Village. And then, like, this bird guy comes up from through the wind.
Which is really cool. I think I remember
confirming
that
Falco is now part of the Zelda canon. So Jack should be happy with that. And
He will. Anything Fox Cloud related.
Well, I guess he should be thankful.
Yes, he shall be.
Did none of you see that reference there?
No.
Oh. There's a quote that Falco says in the game, and he goes, "Gee, I guess I should be thankful."
Oh, yeah, I'm on you now. I got you.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Sorry. I hate just having to explain it.
Obscure references, Matt. Jeez.
We should be at the top of our game, and you two are just not there. God.
Sorry, just a full day's work, and it's just, you know.
Nah, I'm just like being a twat. I'm sorry.
It's not good.
But yeah, and then what was the most interesting was a look at either Zelda. Well, I think one of the two female characters are Zelda, but. A good theory has been going around is that the first female character shown off was the female version of Link.
What, you mean Linkle? The different alternate version of that Link.
A good while back, Emily Rogers said about three facts about Zelda. She got the fact that it was getting ported to Switch correct. The other one was about voice acting, but the one that seemed to cause most attention was the fact that you can now play as a female Link as in addition to a male Link.
I think there was a lot of talk about this a long time ago, though. I think it's when they announced Linkle, back when they did Hyrule Warriors Legends, and people. I think it sparked the whole thing of like they're having a female Link now from now on instead of like Linkle, because that's kind of a different arc or canon or whatever it is.
Yeah.
So I think that's probably why we're now looking at having maybe a female Link, which I could see how they could pull that off with the hairstyle and stuff and everything.
I think, to be honest, if they're going to do it in any Zelda game, this kind of seems to be the one. Because it is quite a vast kind of exploring sort of game. We're not sure how that's going to work in terms of the kind of narrative. So could be that it lends itself quite nicely to giving you a bit more option with your character.
Do you reckon that's why we've had a delay? Because they wanted to add this in, or they had it planned all along?
I'm not sure. I think it's just the fact that I think this is what Arunuma said back at E3, is that they just had to get the physics engine right. I think that's what they're trying to work towards.
Do we know if the Switch and the Wii U version are coming out kind of simultaneously?
Yeah, so I think that's still on the cards. Or at least I'd imagine so.
Would hope so, because they can't just release like the Wii U version and then expect everybody to wait for the Switch version to come out because the Switch gets delayed. That's a bit unfair.
Yeah.
Yeah, probably a bit of an underhanded business move to do that, because they know people can't wait.
But yeah, it looks amazing. We'll be going back to it in towards the end of this section because it was shown at Jimmy Fallon. But yeah, I thought the demo also looked quite fun as well. What do you guys think of the demo that was shown off?
Pretty cool. Just helps to give us a bit more of a taste of what it's like.
Yeah, it's just pretty immersive, really, and just similar to kind of my thoughts when the Sun and Moon demo sort of was around, that it's just kind of orientating you into the kind of whole world to kind of get an idea of what this game is actually going to look like, which I think is great, really, and kind of whets your appetite, doesn't it?
Definitely. Just want to play it. That's what I say now.
Yeah. We want to play it, yeah. Anyway, moving away from Zelda and going into Pokemon, we've got three Pokemon games to talk about. Pokemon GO, relevant as always. I haven't put it in the notes here, but they are going to be teaming up, well, they have teamed up with Starbucks in North America, at least. So pretty much all of their cafes are now Pokestops, and now you could also get a new Pokemon GO-themed Frappuccino.
God.
Yeah, it includes berries, so it's very kind of on point with the game. Yeah. But I think it's pretty pretty naff name. I think it's just called the Go, or the Go Frappuccino.
Jeez.
I think it's just like a case of like being a bit too late. If this was around the time when Pokemon Go was actually popular, then this would be massive, but like, it's just dead now.
Yeah, it's not as widely used as it was when it first came out.
That's true.
I mean, having said that, though, the I know the Halloween event was kind of impressive.
Yeah, that saw a lot of people returning, so we may have seen, because they recently had the Double XP and Double Stardust event, so, but I don't think we've got any statistics from that.
But I think they are just going to have to keep doing these little injections to kind of get people back. I'll play it for a week again.
But what may getting people back in is that Pokemon Go, and just Pokemon in general, they've announced that they'll be making an announcement on the 12th. This episode is recorded on the 9th of December, by the way, regarding new Pokemon coming to the game. So this is very big. I hope they don't just say, oh, now you can get the legendaries. And then there we go. And it's like, well, that's a bit underwhelming. It's good that we can get the legendaries, but it's just like, can't we also get Gen 2 now? Like,
you know? Yeah, I mean, my other possible thoughts on this is that they will try and maybe bring some of the Alolan forms in. Just a kind of a bit of a curveball. Everyone's kind of expecting Gen 2. But whether they want to kind of use it as a bit of a platform for Sun and Moon.
It'd be interesting to see how they do it, though, because, like, the specific requirements, and to be honest, it'd be a bit difficult to do that in Pokemon Go, because how the hell are you going to get those items?
That's true. I mean, most of them do candies anyway, so you don't have to trade Haunter to get Gengar, for example. Mm-hmm. So, I don't know.
The other thing as well is just, regarding that Sun and Moon thing, I think even though, logically, it'd be best to do it generation by generation, given, like, Sun and Moon have just released, I think it would do well for them to include Pokémon Sun and Moon Pokémon in the game and say, oh, Pokémon Sun and Moon is a new Pokémon game and it's now out for Nintendo 3DS systems for so-and-so price. Because we saw none of that. And Pokémon Go, I think, was the biggest factor, and we'll get into this in just a bit. But Pokémon Sun and Moon have already sold, like, incredibly well. So I don't see why they don't strike while the iron is hot, to be fair.
Yeah, it would make sense to me, definitely.
Regarding Alolan forms, though, I'm not sure how exactly that would work. I guess it's just like different types of Pokemon just appear randomly, but I'm not too sure. I may just be thinking about it too much. Most likely it will be, but oh well.
I mean, a good number of them are... I'm just trying to think, things like the Meowth and Rattata. They could do something as simple as, if it's night, you're going to encounter the Alolan.
That would be a good way of doing it, I think, yeah. But I think the most obvious thing is Generation 2 Johto Pokemon are coming in with this announcement. Because we've already had the Daemoners and, you know, it's just logical.
Yeah. Have you been saving up your Zubat and Onyx candies?
I have to, yeah. Yeah, it's been a good amount, hasn't there? A good amount of more evolutions introduced in Gen 2. Like Steelix, Pichu, Igglybuff, just to name a few.
Yeah, I mean, even... I'm guessing that, yeah, they would just... In terms of the Pokemon that are baby Pokemon, whether they would replace, say, let's say you get Pikachu in an egg, would you now get Pichu instead? Or would That's it just go point. Alongside it?
That would make sense, too.
That would make sense, yeah. Yeah, so that's it for Pokemon Go.
Not too long to wait.
Not too long, thankfully. It's only until Monday. But a spin-off that I'm a huge fan of, Pokemon Tournament. I think this will likely be his final fighter, additional fighter in Japan, at least, unfortunately. And Partyon. Yes.
The butler Pokemon.
Yes.
And Partyon has a special place in my heart, because Piplup was my first... Sam, what are you laughing at?
I love teasing you, it's so much fun.
Just be quiet, alright?
Careful, drink some.
Just...
I mean, Empoleon and Dartrix between them would probably run a pretty tight event.
Yeah! Just swash the hair, it's like, yeah. Oh, you're so... Don't touch your hair.
What am I gonna do with you two? Jeez. Yeah. So, have you guys both seen the trailer?
Not yet. No.
No, I haven't. To be honest.
I think he's classified as the Emperor Pokemon, I believe. And he certainly seems like it. He seems like a proud character. Like when I think this may be his entrance animation or something, but he just surfs in, dusts off the water. I know dust isn't the best way to describe it, but he just gets it off his chest and then he just like waves to the audience. So it's just like a very pride character, proud character, rather.
Well, like the top of his head is like a crown, isn't it?
Yeah,
it's got those trident like crown headpiece, isn't he? So.
And he just like looks good fun to play, but I think did we talk about Krogunk being in Pokken?
We did, yes.
Yeah, I think Empoleon seems more of a power character from what I've seen. We see it looks fun. I'll definitely try him out. That is, if it was coming to the Wii U version, but it's not because Wii U's dead.
Oh,
I know, it's a sad thing to say, but it's true.
Actually, I'm just, like, as you're talking, I've just loaded up the video. He actually just surf in on a giant surf wave, and he's just like, you fight me!
Yeah, yeah.
He's very pompousy, proud, slightly. Mm. Looks like he's got a very good moveset.
He does.
Yeah, I've just seen the bit where you said about him hailing to the crowd as well.
Yeah.
It's... He does seem like he's got a good set on him. It would be nice if we had the definite that, yeah, he's coming to the Wii U version, but I don't know.
See, like, that's the problem. I feel like they should have been added to the Wii U version. Like, that would be good.
Yeah.
You know?
It's one of the things, actually, that has put me off playing Pokken. Really, because I mean, we're seeing so many updates of characters released for the arcade version or just Japan, and it just, why would I want to buy a game which hasn't got everything that it could have and should have?
I almost feel like shame. A little betrayed, because it's like I got this in the face that, like, you know, it's a good game and more is going to be coming out, and now it's like you're telling us about all these characters, but we're not getting them. I don't feel
betrayed as such, because I got Pokken, and I don't think at the time I bought it, there wasn't any plans for DLC. and I never really got promised it, but I do see the point where it's like, why just release it exclusive for arcade and not give something for the Wii U version? So, but I do remember a good while back is that Nintendo UK or Nintendo Europe, they did put out that Darkrai was coming to the Wii U version, like a month after the arcade version or something like that. So I don't know where that went to. Like, and I saw it, and I tried to check on it, and it got deleted.
Into the dark void.
Yeah. Oh, by that reference there.
That's getting you back for your Falco reference.
Yeah, fair enough. it was done better as well, because people actually got it. But what I think, because of that, I think that we may be seeing out a Switch version, which I wouldn't mind.
But then it means buying a whole game again.
Yeah, that's true.
But I mean, they could package it as a complete version, couldn't they, with all of the arcade stuff, and I think that would be enough to sell it to me personally.
Yeah. And just add, like, Greninja in there, because it's Greninja. It's the most obvious choice. I wouldn't mind seeing, like, Alola Pokemon added. Like, say,
Alola and Raichu. Yep, definitely. Oh yes. Yeah, all over that.
Oh, Jack's favourite. God.
I call him Surfachu.
Oh, that's a good name. That's a good name.
Yep, that's why I named mine. He's so awesome.
I think when I get mine, I'm just going to call it better than Gen 1 Raichu.
Chubby Chu.
Oh, I used to like that guy.
Oh, yeah, I do, but I just want to piss off Jack.
I like Raichu. He's so cool. Yeah, like somebody Raichu. Made the joke, like, it's a Raichu that went underneath a sand belt. I'm like, no! They didn't round out the edges, they just made him more adorable.
What would you guys think about Alolan Exeggutor in Pokken Tournament? I'm kind of seeing, you know, Street Fighter, you've got, is it Darsin or the guy with the stretchy arm? Really
oh my god.
Something like that, I think would be pretty cool.
Basically all you could do is a headbutt. Just
flailing the head around.
Like, in a practical sense, support Pokemon at least. Like, it has to happen. Just like, he just like goes down and just like does like a massive sweep and it completely trips them up. That would be just amazing, I think.
Comes does a 360, spins around and just knocks you off your feet.
I would have said Incineroar, but you already have Pikachu Libre, so that may have taken it away. And the same thing.
No, give him a rival. Give him a rival.
Well, Hawlucha.
Yeah, I'm surprised he's not in there, to be honest.
I think it's only Bregson is the only Kalos fighter, I believe. And if I'm not mistaken, Suicune is the only Johto one, or less.
Yeah, but Suicune is the only Johto type. But hey ho,
let's go into the next news topic.
Oh, that's
thank you. Pokémon Sun and Moon stuff. Now, it's become the fastest selling Nintendo titles in Europe, the Americas, Australia, and New Zealand. I think it was last week it was reported that it sold over 7 million copies. And just recently, Nintendo of Europe confirmed that it's sold over 2.1 million in Europe.
Sweet. Go, people. For those who haven't got it, go get it. It's a good game.
So good.
Very good. Well worth the wait.
That's all to say on it.
Go get it. It's a Christmas present.
I'm really happy that it's done really well. Because I think there's been reports that Skylanders, that's dying off and may have even got cancelled.
Thank goodness.
but I'm just glad that like Pokemon is still like alive and kicking, you know. So, and I'm really happy that's like the best selling. Not even just for Pokemon, just like for Nintendo as a whole. I think that's like really cool.
Of course it is. It's Pokemon. Like one of the bigger franchises of Nintendo's lineups.
Well, I mean, just take it into account, like, that's being, like, all the Smash games, all the Mario games, all the Zelda games, and all the Pokemon games prior to this one. It's just... I think it's really cool to see them become, like, the fastest selling.
You remember Mickey, who came on a previous episode? He is currently at the VGC tournaments, national tournaments in London. So I'll add that to shout out later. But
best of luck.
Just thought I, and he had to breed and train all of like the Pokemon that he could actually use because they changed the rules every time. It's like, obviously you have to use the ones that you can currently get in the game and blah blah blah.
And then of course we're 5 days behind, so some late nights, I imagine.
He found a way to hatch eggs faster.
Oh, really?
Without cheating. Yeah, there's a way of doing it.
Nice.
I'll probably share it with everyone. It's basically get the egg, get on the Pokemon ride. Usually like Stoutland is better, if I remember rightly.
Okay.
And just spin around in the circle for ages. I kid you not. We had a Street Pass of Amsterdam event. He was doing it. All I could see on the screen was just this Stoutland going round in circles and circles. What are you doing? I was just watching it. It was so funny. And I was just in tears of laughter because it's just hilarious. He goes, look, it works. He hatched like eggs in like a minute. And I was just like, Jesus Christ.
That's cool.
Oh, God.
I wonder if there's going to be any way to like jockey up a system. Because I remember back in, I think it was Gen 3, you could hatch an egg by going on the bike and kind of going up a ramp. But if you didn't go on the right bike or at the right speed, you didn't go up, you just like slid down. Oh,
that was that Silver and Gold, or there was a specific bit. I know what you mean. You literally could just go up and down on the faster bike, and
people would tape the up button down, so they just kept repeating, and they could sit away from the console. So I'm wondering if there's anything similar we could do to make the stick spin.
It would be very interesting.
Yeah, I don't think there's an area like Lumios City in Sun and Moon.
No, there isn't, sadly.
But yeah, but we'll be talking about Pokémon Sun and Moon later on in our What Have You Been Playing section. Right, moving on to Switch stuff. We've got a decent amount. First of all, let's talk about Super Mario Run. So this was announced a good while back. And I think to everyone's surprise as well, I don't think many people saw this coming at Apple's event. So it'll be coming timed exclusive, I believe, to iOS and iPad devices. It'll be around about £10, I believe. £7.99 maybe over here. I'm not too sure. But I'll be coming December 15th. You can be playing it with one hand. You can play it as Luigi or Yoshi as well, and a Toad from my Nintendo. Which is still a thing, surprisingly, my Nintendo. God, I thought that was long forgotten
it's
about.
Gone very quiet on that's that.
I hope the Switch fixes my Nintendo, like makes it more integrated. I really hope so, because we were promised so much from my Nintendo, and then at launch, it's like, you could get costumes for Miitomo, an app no one uses.
There are costumes for Miitomo.
I know, but like,
there's new ones at the moment. Hmm.
And I just feel like my Nintendo is just like, just for Miitomo and just to get discounts off of games. That's all it seems like to me at the moment, personally. But anyway, real rant over, but Super Mario Run, it can't be played offline, so you always have to have an internet connection. And the main reason is just like to make it more secure. Just general thoughts on Super Mario Run.
I can't even play it until they decide to bring it to Android, because I don't have an iPhone.
Dear.
I'm same boat, actually.
Oh, really?
However, having seen some of the gameplay, it does look a lot kind of more flexible than I thought it would, and just being able to do those kind of like wall jumps and things like that. Kind of initially, when I pictured it in my head, it was just tap A, jump over a Goomba.
Yeah.
But they do seem to have done quite a lot with it. and some quite clever things, really, to kind of for a tapping game. So yeah, if I did have the appropriate platform, I'd probably pick it up. But yeah, until then, I'd have to wait till it comes to Android.
Sad times.
I get it next week. That is if I put down the money.
You're the guinea pig.
I am the guinea pig. No. Jimmy Fallon is the guinea pig.
This is true, yes.
But yeah, just a bit of that Jimmy Fallon bit in a little while. I am a bit annoyed that Super Mario Run will not be able to play on offline. I think that's a bit annoying. I could kind of understand why, and I do like it being more secure. Because it's launching within about 150 countries simultaneously, I believe. So that is big. But I just would like to be the ability to just play like on the go without having to use a lot. Hopefully it doesn't use a lot of data. If it does, then I'll be a bit annoyed. But
I'm assuming it's going to be pinging sort of scores and things and that sort of thing, is it?
That's probably going to be the only thing it's going to need to do. The rest of it will just be pure gameplay. Yeah. Unless it's like microtransactional stuff, then they'll probably start needing data.
Hopefully it won't take too much data. If it does, then I'll be really annoyed because I'll really take... Well, Pokemon Go, that doesn't use a lot, does it? Like
no. Not really.
But then again, so hopefully he uses around about the same amount. But yeah, Super Mario Run, it is looking interesting. I think I may just pick it up. I think I may be tempted to get it.
Just the advert for the Nintendo Super Mario Run is really cheesy.
Oh, it is. Like, with everyone running.
So many people just running and stuff. I'm just like, okay.
No one's dressed as a cat, are they?
No, thank God not. So. But it's loads of different countries and different people running.
And a baby and an extra jogger and then just like parkourer.
Yeah, the guy who's really quiet and then he breaks through and Super Mario Run! And then there's Mario at the front in New York, I think.
And he gets on like a little flagpole and everyone's like, yeah! And
here
we go! Shut up. So cringy.
The overly excited kid with the Mario in the phone. I'm just like, oh my dear God, that's so cringy.
Yeah.
So is Mario going back to his Boston roots?
Boston? Oh.
No, Brooklyn, not Boston.
Oh man, that's a faux pas. Yeah, oh, Brooklyn. God. Sorry, that's bad, isn't it?
Dude.
Oh. But I put that one in there intentionally, you see.
Yeah, intentionally.
All right, we'll try that again. Is he going back to his Brooklyn roots?
Most probably. One of the pasta, yeah.
Hey, yo, wait, yo. I'm on the mobile. That's a really shit Mario impression, I'm sorry.
No!
I'm not even going to attempt it, like God.
Oh, well. Anyway, next new piece of news.
Anyway, so now we're getting on to Switch stuff. A big one, it's not confirmed, it's just sources, but it's from Eurogamer yet again. We may be seeing a GameCube Virtual Console with the Switch, which is something I'd say a lot of people have been asking for a long, long time, especially when the GameCube controller adapter was announced a good while back for the Wii U. Mm. So I believe the first three games that will be coming will be Super Mario Sunshine, Luigi's Mansion, and Super Smash Bros. Melee.
First two I'd say definitely good. Not sure about Melee. Probably only because it was one of the more popular of the four titles. Is that right in saying?
Yeah, I think it would be an odd move in a way, because if anything it would hurt sales of any kind of Switch version, because like you said, Melee is kind of held up in such high regard by it was such like a competitive game with such a big kind of scene, and I know it's still played a lot even now.
Mm.
So it would be interesting what kind of implications that would have and whether people would take that back up.
I think this is a smart move, really, because I think Melee HD, I'm not sure if it is a joke or just like something that people generally want, but Melee HD is a thing that Melee fans have been begging for a good while. And just like being able to just practice on the go. In addition to just like being on the faster console. I think that'd be a big plus, but I think Melee and Smash 4 are really different games.
Oh yeah, of course they are.
Yeah, so I think they won't detract from that. I think people will see just how much more content the new Smash game will have. Like, it has over double the amount of characters, a lot more stages, just a lot online capabilities, all that. Whereas Melee is just more casual. Well, not casual. Don't quote me on that, but...
the reason, like, some people prefer Melee is because of some of the, like, tactics and mechanics that you can get, wave dash and L cancel.
Yeah, it's mainly, like, the mechanics and just, like, how everything plays. Seeing it in action, it's definitely, like, a faster-paced game.
That raises the point. Do you think they might have fixed things and adjusted
it? I hope not. I think that's the problem. I hope they don't, because I think what's important with emulation is that... here's two things. With Pokemon's Red, Blue, and Yellow, did they keep him missing, though, and all those odd glitches and stuff like that?
Yeah.
I believe they did,
yeah. They did, yeah.
They're
so
still there.
I hope that, like, they just continue that with all their games, because I think that just helps it be really authentic.
Well, I mean, to be honest, if it is the virtual console, it should just be the original game, shouldn't it? Just with mapped out... obviously differently mapped controllers and the options that you need, and it's almost like emulated anyway, isn't it?
It's pretty much emulated.
Not going to be a remastered version or anything, but, I wouldn't have thought.
Yeah, but that brings me on to my next point. The people behind the emulation are forget the name, I'm sorry, but they're the people behind the NES Classic Mini nerd, who which I believe stands for, let me just get it here, it stands for Nintendo European something development. I'm going to say research
and development.
Most likely, yeah. Sorry, this is bad preparation, but oh well. Yeah, so
those guys.
Yeah, so Nintendo European Research and Development, or NERD, they're the studio behind the NES Mini. So. And a lot of people have actually praised this emulation, saying that's far better than the Wii U emulation. So if they are going to indeed be behind the virtual console for the Switch, that'd be great. It's going to get great emulation, and you know, I can't wait, especially for someone that would love to play GameCube games. I think hopefully they'll be around about £15. I think that would be the best price. Personally, because it's like there's games there about £350. £350. There's games are like £450, and GBA games are like £6 to £7. Nintendo 64 and I think DS games as well to around about £10. And then you've got Wii games that are around £20. So those are all the virtual console platforms on the Wii U and the prices. I think GameCube games would be good to do £15.
Yeah, it shouldn't be any more than that.
Because like even at a CEX, like Smash Melee is like £25. Like I want to play games like Kirby Air Ride and all that without having to pay a fortune.
Kirby Air Ride's awesome. I can't believe I gave that up.
Really?
Yeah, I had the physical copy, and then I traded it in for something else, but it was a dumb move. I don't know why I did that.
Yeah, but like even just games like Super Mario Sunshine or Luigi's Mansion, I think it would be just great just to be able to play these on the go. I'm not too bothered, but I think there is concern about the analog controls for Smash Melee, because if they're not supported, then that may raise a question to where the Switch... emulation may be the standard now for competitive Melee over just the normal GameCube. So that is something to consider, but I hopefully they have like they'll bring back the GameCube adapter, because it makes sense. And there was this one idea a good while back, is that there are this GameCube version of the Joy-Con controllers. So like one half of the right side, the other half of the left side. I think that would do quite well, albeit a bit clunky.
The GameCube adapter works on USB, and I would have thought that they'd have done that with the Switch as well, because it's still a current thing that, in technology to have USB, so I don't think we'll have any worries about that, honest.
I think as we can see that they have USB ports.
I don't think we've got anything to worry about, to be honest.
Obviously, the big question is, are you going to be able to use your Donkey Kongo bongos on there?
Oh, God.
That's what everyone wants to know.
Well, I think the...
But it's my best play style. I gotta have my bongos. Gotta beat out a rhythm, beat the snot out of them.
Sorry, slightly derailed there. But, had to be asked.
It's alright.
Alright.
we submitted you into a flurry of fits and giggles.
No, it's just like I've just thought of a potential title. So like, just potential title. It's. Have you seen it, Sam?
I've just seen it. Yeah.
Yeah. So like, there's hailing from the 2D era, into the dark void, and now beating your bongos.
Oh God.
And I'm gonna put it in brackets. Definitely not. A euphemism.
Oh, we love euphemisms.
I spelled that wrong though. There we are. And I take English for A level.
Oh. So I'm a teacher and I didn't spot it.
Oh really? Oh nice. So I am very interested in seeing what exactly the first console will have in store. Hopefully it will be GameCube. Hopefully that will even be like one of the first console supported for virtual console. I think that would lead up very well personally. But I don't think there's really much need for a Wii U virtual console, considering a lot are getting ported over to the Switch. I think we covered last time. What was it? So we have Smash Wii U, Splatoon, Super Mario Maker, and Xenoblade Chronicles X. And Mario Kart 8. Those five, I think they're pretty much the biggest, I'd say. So I think that would be quite wise to just bring those over, and that will be fine, personally.
Yeah, pretty much.
But no, it's very interesting to see how Nintendo handle virtual console this time round.
Let's hope they learned from mistakes and get it even better.
Hopefully you don't have to pay for another game for the fourth time in a row. I've heard a lot of complaints about that.
Yeah, most probably.
Anyway,
yeah. It'll be interesting to see whether... Because obviously with the Wii U, there was a kind of... You could do the system transfer, and you had the Wii mode that you could flip into to get your games from the Wii virtual console. So whether anything like that will be kind of inherent in the Switch.
Hopefully.
I'd hope so.
It didn't work for me. I lost it all. It was a real pain. But hey-ho. Don't dwell on it. We just carry on and have some fun.
Yeah. We're moving on again to Switch. We have got another game confirmed. It's Seasons of Heaven. It comes from French indie studio Any Arts Productions, and it's a Nintendo Switch exclusive. I'm not sure if I already said that. I'm not too sure. I think I have short-term memory loss today. But it's also running on Unreal Engine 4. Have you guys seen the screenshots for this?
Yes. They look absolutely gorgeous.
Oh my god. Like, I'm just happy that this is a Switch exclusive, because it just shows just how beautiful Switch games will look now.
It like, I'm looking at one now just to remind myself, but it's like the little kid in a field like with cherry blossoms and this huge expanse and this tower. It's amazing. It's absolutely amazing.
I have to say, it just looks gorgeous. Like there's no way of like this is an indie game as well. Like
yeah, that's what I was gonna say. This is how you present an indie title.
So yeah, I think what's quite interesting to say though is that although all of the screenshots I've seen anyway have been kind of areas of outstanding beauty, but the source material for the game is apparently based off a French novel, which is actually set in a kind of post-apocalyptic world.
Oh, okay.
So it's whether kind of that's going to transfer into the game, I'd imagine so. But obviously what we're seeing now isn't maybe what we'll see for a lot of the game.
Who knows? Hopefully. Well, maybe like it's... Well, on the Eurogamer article, it says a post-civilization world.
Okay. So... Well, I think in the novel as well, though, it's a lot of kind of animal species have died out and the kind of earth has been poisoned and it sounds pretty horrendous. So...
I'm quite glad that it doesn't really look like that because it just looks... stunning to look at. I may just pick it up just to like look at it.
I think it is going to be quite a game that tells a good story as well, because I think from the source material the main character supposedly has Asperger's syndrome and he has this kind of psychic connection with his dog
which you can actually play as both characters.
You can switch between the dog and I think it's Yan is the boy and Annie is the dog.
Yeah.
And you can switch between the two, which should be quite an interesting dynamic, really.
Very interesting. Hopefully we'll get more info on Jan 12th. But if you do need a look at the Switch, look no further than Jimmy Fallon, of all people. So, this came as a bit of a surprise, because it was confirmed, I can't remember when, but it was good amount of time, I think, that Super Mario 1 would appear on Tonight with Jimmy Fallon, in America, of course. That's all we thought we were getting, so I don't think many people actually cared to look at it all that much. But then, like, towards the end, after the demo finished of Super Mario Run, then Reggie just showed off the Switch, just, like, out of nowhere. You know,
it does seem to characterise the Switch kind of promotion, really, doesn't it? Just that, oh yeah, by the way, here you go, here's the Switch. It's kind of what happened when we first saw that trailer. It was like, oh yeah, in the next couple of days, there's going to be a trailer. And people have been waiting for such a long time, so they're really kind of going for the shock factor, aren't they?
Definitely. Like, I think they only gave the original reveal trailer like about 12 hours.
Yeah, something crazy, wasn't
that's
it?
Like, jeez, like, it's just no. Well, not no, but it's just so little time.
But I think, I think that's what makes it successful, because they're kind of banking all the hype, and everyone's kind of going crazy and frenzied on social media and stuff, and I think they've tapped into it well. And having a look at that video earlier, the amount of kind of shares and watches that video's had, and it's a real kind of trending clip.
Right now it's number 9 on trending, even 2 days after its reveal.
And
that's very promising about the Switch. Very promising. So it just shows that, like, and I think this was important. I think it would have fit better if it had appeared at the Game Awards, because of course it's gaming related, of course. And you know, they also showed off Zelda at the Game Awards, but they also showed off Zelda here as well, running on the Switch. But by having it on Jimmy Fallon's show, especially to like such a wide audience, they just increase that much attention to themselves.
Yeah, I think that says kind of sums up Nintendo, really, doesn't it? Who they're going for. You know, they could show it to the kind of gamers.
Yeah.
But, you know, they've just gone for kind of cast the net as wide as they can, really.
Yeah. And I think I've said this before on the show before, but I just think we're looking at a new Nintendo here.
I think, hopefully, they just like I keep saying this, they keep learning from past mistakes.
It was just like very straightforward. And they even demonstrated the. Although I think Reggie did seem to be hiding a bit of it. The process from TV to the tablet, but he showed it off working, and it actually worked. So I'm very interested to see what it will actually look like in my hands when I actually get it for myself.
The weight of it will be interesting as well, actually.
The weight of it will be...
And the material and all of those kind of things that you really need from something you're going to have in your hand for a long time.
Yep. But thankfully, the Switch event is after my MOX. And thankfully, it's still sunny leave. So I don't have to go into school that day. So I'm very happy. Yeah, I'm very happy that I'll be able to just stay home and watch it then. I just want to bring up the January 12th event just quickly, because like PlayStation recently had the PlayStation Experience event. I wasn't able to watch it live, unfortunately, but I'd take a guess that it was very similar to. I'd say it's probably similar to its E3 presentation, where at E3 this year for PlayStation, they just like did game after game after game, and hopefully Nintendo won't stutter or anything like that. Hopefully they won't be drag anything out for too long. Same with demo ring or anything like that. I don't think we need another demo for Zelda Breath of the Wild. I just want to see like information on this system, maybe Virtual Console, a good amount of games, more info about the Switch, more info about the games, and then just end it off with a proper release date and Mark Evans from InnoZoom 11 coming into Smash for Switch. And then it's like, bam, that's how you reveal console.
Yeah, I think they definitely need... They put a lot of weight behind Zelda, but given that it's not a launch title now... They kind of need to do a lot more.
Or at least we don't think. That's just a rumour, I believe.
Oh, is it? Okay.
Yeah. But I would take a good guess in that it will be around about summer, which I think is wise. It seems like a good summer game.
Yeah, I think what we've got to remember is anything that doesn't come from Nintendo directly or announced on their official sites
is just a rumour.
It's just speculation and rumour, so we have We have to be careful.
Yeah, but certainly be interested to see what they do kind of put as their kind of first team game-wise at a full launch.
Yeah, they're keeping their cards very close to their chest.
Very much so. So like that wraps that up for the news section here. So let's move on to what have you been playing. So this is what have we been playing, where we just talk about what have we been playing. So Ian, what have you been playing?
Well, probably quite predictable, but I have been playing a lot of Pokémon Sun.
Yeah,
that's the kind of the very kind of
well, the I game. Think, I think everybody has. Time. Yeah, everybody has.
Yep.
Yeah. So thoroughly enjoying that.
You've completed it, haven't you?
I've completed the main game.
Yeah.
The kind Jeez. Of the main story.
I haven't got that far yet. Probably because I kept chopping and changing my mind on what Pokemon I want. Terrible. Oh,
yeah, so that's been great. And now I'm kind of just going back and doing all the stuff I missed on the way, because there's lots of those little things buried away.
Yeah.
And just kind of enjoying it and getting ready to start doing some competitive battling.
Important question. Right. Who's your team?
So my current team... that I've just kind of finished the game with. I've got Primarina. So I went for Popplio.
God.
I know.
Sorry. God.
It's the worst starter. Rowlet is the best.
In your opinion.
Yes, in my right in my right opinion, Sam.
Yeah.
Who did you go for then, Matthew?
Rowlet.
I went with everybody else because I like Rowlett.
Well, yeah, but
I like
Rowlett
the hair because I kept him as Dartrix.
Have you not
like
seen? Have you not seen the anime? Rowlett's the best, no question.
Well, I hadn't seen that before I chose.
Fair enough. But then again,
to be honest, it's a better design. I do admit that, but. I kind of knew everyone would be going for that, yeah. So I thought I'd just choose the one it was weak to.
Yeah,
you know?
I really do like the starters all around, really. Like, I do like Poppy. I'm not too keen on Brionne, but I do quite like Primarina, to be fair. I do quite...
Yeah, no, Brionne is pretty cool. Ugly.
I wouldn't say it's ugly, it's just, like, looks a bit...
It's very feminine. Yeah. If you got a boy one, that's just...
Yeah. But then again, it's like Incineroar, like... It's weird having like a female in Cinderella as well, isn't it? So
I could see possibly getting away with it, like design wise. If you look at it, it can be female, but the whole it being sort of similar to a wrestler, yes, it does kind of give more of a masculine look.
But it, I mean, it can't be worse than having a male Salazzle,
oh,
which
God,
which you can't have, but that would be horrendous.
That'd be awkward.
can't
you have like a female Mr. Mime?
You can, yes.
That doesn't make sense.
Hello, I'm Mr. Mime. Like,
we're not here to judge.
Okay.
you
do your thing.
I think we may be pissing off Tumblr, so let's just move on to another topic.
Anyway, so yeah, Primarina, that's one.
Cool.
I've got the midday version of Lycanroc.
Oh, cool.
So I found pretty reliable, actually. And
Yeah,
definitely. Pretty good attacker, really. Accelerock is incredibly handy. It's the kind of priority rock attack.
Okay.
So that's been good. Who else have we got? Crabonibobble, which I can never say the name of, especially on podcasts.
The evolution, the crab one, isn't it?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Oh, yeah, Crabula. I like Crabula. I have.
Yeah, he's pretty cool. Let's see, who else do I have? Ooh, kind of getting stuck here. I think I had Alolan Golem.
All right.
Which is interesting, given that it's electric type as well. So a bit out there. And yeah, I've kind of chopped and changed as I went. I did definitely have an Alolan Persian for a while. But as the game went on, he kind of dropped off in usefulness.
Yeah, I don't like the bee-stung-faced Persian.
No, but at least as the player, you only have to look at him from behind, so you don't get to see that face.
That's true.
it's everyone else you're fighting.
It's
has
the
to
giant
look at it.
Swollen heads. It's
yeah.
Like...
It's like on Animal Crossing, you know, when you get stung, isn't
it? Yeah. It's like, go to bed, wake up. Oh, you're fine now.
You can buy medicine too, I think, can't you?
Yeah, that gets rid of it.
Nothing works on Alolan Persian.
Matt, who's your team?
Let me see if I still have it open. Because I have my...
Whilst you're getting yours, I could tell you mine off the top of my head. I have Alolan Raichu.
Of course.
Which I'm so happy at getting. And luckily, I managed to teach Pikachu Thunderbolt before I evolved it. Because if you don't teach it Thunderbolt, you can't use the special Z move. And
Are we talking about Raichu?
Stoked Surf.
Surfing. Can it only work with Thunderbolt then?
Yep, it only works with Thunderbolt. There's certain like specific Pokemon type moves only work with a specific move.
Yeah, I think Snorlax works only with Giga Impact, I believe.
Yes, I believe so.
That sucks.
But yeah, I've got Alolan Raichu, I've got Absol, I've got Arcanine, I have Leafeon, because I had to keep one Eevee in there.
Yeah,
God.
Of course.
Before I had this team, I had all Eevees. I had Sylveon, Vaporeon, Jolteon, Leafeon, Umbreon, and Espeon, which I've just got now, which was going to go in anyway. Who else have I got? I've got Greninja, because I got that transferred over from the Battle Bonds.
How early in the game did you transfer that across?
Straight away.
Really?
Okay, and so does it start as a kind of, what level is it when you get it?
36. Problem is, you can't use it properly until you beat the first Kahuna, because he won't listen to you.
I did see that on the demo version, because I kind of only just transferred mine over post-game.
That's what I'm planning on doing. That's what I'm planning on doing as well.
So
It did say like you have to beat 2 Grand Trials.
You could beat the first Grand Trial and use him, but then once he goes to level 37, you're kind of a bit screwed, really, because he won't listen. Luckily, like, I've sort of gradually leveled him, so he's all right at the moment. I think I'm on the last island, if I remember rightly. So he still listens. He's good. Yep. He's quite handy. He's got quite a wide variety of moves. I don't think I've missed anyone. I can't remember. So I know. Matt, have you got your team?
Yeah, so like what I've enjoyed about this is just like catching a lot of Pokemon. I'm gonna bother about, so in my first box I have my squad box. And so I just like switch it out as like, so I say fit. So I don't have like a definite 6 right now.
Who are the ones you generally main then?
Let's see, so of course, I'm only just about to take on the second trial, so I've just beaten Gladion for the first time. I'm that far behind. I'm sorry. I'm a year 30 main level student. I have a lot.
No,
of
I meant Gladion.
Oh,
I don't like him.
Oh, that hand.
I know his story. I still don't like him.
Oh. He grew on me personally. He's not bad.
Okay.
It's the whole like, for a kid's game, there's this kid that's holding his wrist and shaking his hand. He's like,
it's but like, he's so edgy.
It's too edgy, Matt, for a kid's game.
Oh no, but his battle theme is just like gorgeous. Like, you can't deny his battle theme.
That's the thing. Actually, I've just found out what my sixth one is. It's the midnight form of Rockruff.
Yeah.
Yes, Lycanroc.
Lycanroc, he's so lovely. I like him. He's. I personally prefer him over the midday form.
Okay. Well, design-wise, isn't that?
Yeah, I don't know. Just like the whole, it's like midnight, werewolfish. Yeah, I like him. He's really cool. But also, when you evolve a normal Gen 1 Pokemon into an Alolan form, the evolution music is different to the normal music.
Really?
Yeah, it's different. If you ever, if you get like Execute and evolve it into Alolan Executor, turn the volume up. No joke. It's good music. It's really Hawaiian-y style. Oh. I was like, because I got Raichu, which was the first one, and I was like, hang on, this sounds different. And then it's like, oh my god, it's different. And then I did the Executor. I was just like, oh my god, this is awesome. Makes you want to go catch more of the Alolan types. So yeah, little bit there for people who haven't had that yet.
Yeah, so my...
Anyway, sorry, Matt, I didn't interrupt.
Yeah, that's right. So in my squad box, let's say I have Mudbray, Magnemite, Diglett, Jigglypuff, Grimer, Crabrawler, Herdia, Rockruff, Machop, Kadabra, Trumbeak, and Young Goose. But my solid 5, I'd say, right now, would be Dartrix, Cutiefly,
cool.
Pikachu, Ghastly, and Snorlax.
You got a Pikachu?
Yeah, I've got a Pikachu.
Don't evolve it until level 42, then.
42, alright.
That's when it learns Thunderbolt.
Yeah, yeah, so. I meant to ask you about that, yeah.
Yeah, level 42 is when it lands Thunderbolt, so don't evolve it until then. All it needs is a Thunderstone, but seriously, don't evolve it until then, because I don't know where the TM for Thunderbolt is, if it's in there. It probably is, I just don't know where it is at the moment, because like Ian was saying, there's so many little bits in there, it's like going back and trying to find them all. It's just best for him to learn it naturally and then evolve him at 42. And then... Yeah, actually, by the time you get him to 42, you'll be in the right town to get the Z crystal for him. So, yeah, tip for everyone again. Sam's top tips.
some informative soft tips.
So I just want to get your wait, Sam, have you completed it?
No, I'm on, like I said, I'm on the last island.
Oh, okay.
I'm really annoyed because I can't go get a Riolu, which I was going to replace Absol with. You have to be the champion to do it. I'm like, nah, I want a Lucario. Gutted about that.
Right, so Ian, what do you think of the story then, as a whole, without spoiling anything?
Yeah, I really enjoyed it, actually. I definitely kind of, and I said this on Pokémon Voice a few days ago, that I kind of see it as a kind of a split. There's two main things going on, really. You've got your kind of island challenges, and your kind of road to becoming the champion on that side. And then, of course, over the other side, you've got your sort of stuff going on with the Aether Foundation and Team Skull and so on and so on. But, I actually found the trials aspect a bit more engaging because that was just something so new.
Aether
Foundation stuff is quite out there, which I think will be a little bit Marmite in that you either love it or hate it.
Oh. Any particular trials that you've found interesting? I know I could probably name one that's worth keeping an eye out for.
There was one with the sound effects, which I found quite interesting.
All right.
That was the electric one, I believe.
Yeah, Sophocles.
Spoil it for me.
Yeah.
Sorry. I was trying to be quite general.
I like the fire one. I literally was laughing my head off.
Yeah. There's some good moments in that, actually.
Yeah.
Particularly the last particular...
The very last one.
Shot.
I have to say, I'm liking the island trial. Like, I've only done one, fair enough, but it just does feel different. But still,
they do vary. It's not just a Pokemon battle. It's more, this is the objective, and then this is what you've got to do, and then you've got to go try and do it. And it's like,
Oh, but can we just have a moment just to appreciate Team Skull as the best team in any Pokemon game? Like,
they rhyme and they rap and you could basically just diss them at every turn.
Yeah, that's what it was. It's like there was this one picture, I believe it's like from a Pokemon parody account or something like that. Basically, it was just like this Tumblr post of like every citizen from like every other region. It's like, oh no, it's this team. Oh no, it's Team Rocket again in Johto. And then like Kalos is just like, oh no, it's Team Flare, and then it's like Alola, Citizens. It's just like LMAO is Team Skull. It's just like, that just sums it up perfectly. It's like,
they're just there like, yo, you remember us, right? And you're just like,
are you just like talking to Illima? Like, Illima's just like, oh, so you did catch this Pokemon, and it's like, they're just so irrelevant, but like, that's, they just have so much personality, Team Skull.
They're just like, dude, that's cold.
Yeah.
What are you doing, man?
I just love them. I really do. They really do seem like my favourite evil team.
There was a bit where I was like going through and like you fight all the different ones and you get to one. He's just like, look, man, I know when I'm going to lose anyway. Just go. I'm like, really?
So we see you like sat on the floor, slumped around, defeated.
Their boss is really tricky to beat. I find him really difficult sometimes, especially with what's the main one he always keeps throwing out?
Galissapod. Oh, I forgot to mention he was one of the major guys on my team, Galissapod.
Oh, okay.
He is so tricky. It's a water bug type, isn't it?
Yes.
And I just like you can't use fire because the water, and then you could probably the only thing you can really use is electricity because.
Flying and poison, maybe?
I think poison's not as effective on bugs. I think it's more like it's electric for that one, and then flying. So, yeah.
Right.
Need a bread Pokemon. But, yeah, no.
Yeah, I think as well,
hilarious.
It's great to have a team that are kind of bad because they're bad. There's no kind of, like, higher ideology. They're not trying to achieve any kind of particular goals other than just be disruptive and
kind of
annoy.
They're all members who failed the island trials. Help us.
No.
That doesn't spoil it in any way.
Well, I mean, it kind of does. Because I didn't know about it. Well, I know something's up with, like, Guzma and Gookery. There's some beef there, because that was in the trailer. But yeah, thanks for spoiling it, Sam. God.
Sorry.
It
doesn't ruin anything for you, honestly.
It does.
It's just a tidbit of information.
Well, yeah, but it causes a chain and effect of worrying and just need to play it. But then I've also got work to do, so...
It's
just shut up.
Minor in the bigger plot, trust
Fair
me.
Enough. All right.
You can back me up.
Well, like,
on that
I know
you?
There's like...
Yeah, agreed.
I knew, like, Project. Even when Aether Foundation were first shown off, I always knew that they were going to be, like, the true evil team. Or something.
How much do you know about the Aether Foundation, then?
Right, just spoilers, because I don't want to get spoiled out of you, because Sam certainly did for me, and I don't want you feeling the same way.
That but, had an air horn effect over what I just spoiled, then.
Yeah, but, don't tell me if it's true or not, but I believe... I don't know, I just know that, like, Loser Mean, the president or whatever, she gets black hair eventually. Or something. And she's, like, the true evil leader. And that's all I know, because I saw it in the thumbnail.
Yeah, no comment.
Saw it in the thumbnail. Yeah, no comment on that.
Yeah, but, like, I think... So do you think it's a better story than Gen 5? Because Gen 5 has already been... have always been very highly regarded as the best story in Pokémon.
Yes, yeah, I think so.
Nice.
I think it's got more strands to it. So, obviously, Gen 5 had some really cool moments with... is it Plasma, isn't it?
Yeah.
And the fact that it kind of carries over the two sets of games quite nicely. But, yeah, I think this kind of has more things going on. And then post-game as well, it kind of carries on, which is quite nice.
Oh, nice. See, like, the thing that I didn't like about Oras was, like, the Delta episode. Like, it was alright, but all you got was just, like, a lot of, like, going to point A, point B, and then you fight, like, Rayquaza, Cynar, and Deoxys, and then that's it. That's your lot done. It's like, well...
Yeah. I think it was kind of very much an attempt to tie Oras to XY.
I guess so.
And kind of set out the kind of this multiverse thing that they're now going for.
Okay.
So it had some kind of story purpose in that, the Delta episode. The thing that annoyed me about that, to be honest, is that where's my next episode? I want to be able to download some more and catch different legendaries and have little story bits, but yeah, it does make sense.
Yeah, I think I am really enjoying Pokémon Sun. It's really fun. So what else have you been playing, Ian? We've talked so much about Pokémon already.
And that's great. I mean, it's a fantastic game, and it does deserve a lot of airtime. But other than that, obviously not been playing too much because I am a bit of a Pokémaniac. So I've been playing a bit of Twisted Fusion, which my good friend and co-host Lewis is the developer behind.
Nice.
And kind of going through that. So I had quite a lot to do playtesting-wise of the game when it was kind of in development and really enjoyed that. And it's just been really cool seeing it finally on a console and kind of living the dream. and nice to play it not sat next to him. Spoiling it for me and trying to tell me, oh no, go there. Like, shush,
constantly over your shoulder, like, it's good. It's good, Ian.
Yeah.
Tell me it's good, Ian.
Yeah, don't worry. It wasn't quite that needy. But no, just great to play that and kind of explore the little nooks and crannies that I'd forgotten about. A lot of the playtesting was trying specific things. So it's kind of nice to play the game as a whole and do what I want to do, really.
Oh, fair enough.
And then the other game is it's an oldie but a goldie. It's a DS game called Ghost Trick. You heard of that?
Yeah, I've heard of it before. Yeah, it's a sort of like a detective game sort of thing.
Yeah, it's by the makers of Phoenix Wright, or a lot of the team certainly behind Phoenix Wright, and it's kind of almost like a click adventure, but you play a ghost, and you can sort of move into different inanimate objects and sort of possess them, and it's kind of detective-y, it's puzzly, it's got a really cool story that goes with it. So you're this ghost who's basically trying to find out what happened to him and who killed him. But it's got a really nice twist at the end, actually. And then as you go, you develop all these new ghost tricks.
Ghost Trick Phantom Detective.
That's the one. So it's definitely worth a pickup if you can get it for cheap. I managed to kind of just pick up a game. And it's just been really nice to go back to it.
Okay. It does look rather cool. Its hairstyle's quite weird.
Yeah, the it's quite an iconic look, really, isn't it? With the shades and the kind of blonde Elvis-y thing going on. Sissel is the main character's name.
I can get it's like quite spectral, where it's like trailing off into like a wisp. It's very weird. Matt?
Yes?
I was going to say, are you still there, dude?
Yeah. Sam, why don't you go first?
Oh, fine. Well, obviously, we've already discussed Pokemon, so I won't exhaust that any further, because I'm sure everybody's had enough of us going on Pokemon mad. The only thing I say is, my team's basically, I've already said my main one, and then, obviously, I love to get all the EVs. The only one I got to get left now is Glaceon, because I can't get that until post-game. Ooh, brilliant. So, super sad about that. I've been playing just a little bit more Animal Crossing, taking care of my town, making sure my Amiibo-specific characters are all there and happy. I don't want to lose any of them, although I could just recall them using the Amiibo anyway, so it's handy.
How have you found the new content on that was recently released?
It works. I like it and enjoy it. I enjoy the fact I could just kick out a horrible villager if I don't really want them there. But I've got the three ones I had from when I originally moved in, and then all my Amiibo ones, which basically means the town's like full. But yeah, I like it.
Nice.
I think it just keeps it fresh and interesting, and there'll be a day where I'm just like, do you know what, I just need something to chill with, and I'm gonna play this. So yeah, I just go back in and make sure my town's good, and yeah, I love it. I absolutely love it.
I still need to try out that update for Animal Crossing.
Matt,
sorry,
you're missing out. And if you've got Amiibo, you can use the Amiibo.
I know, but I have so much stuff to play. I have so much work to do.
And
so many stuff to write. And so many podcasts to listen to. I just don't have the time.
Podcasts can be squeezed in with gaming. No exceptions.
I guess so, yeah. I think Animal Crossing would be a good game to like listen to podcasts too. I think that would work quite well.
Yeah, it works. Yeah. And then just obviously a little bit of Mario Party Star Rush. I just enjoy that for, you know, mini games and the madness of trying to get all the characters and be like, no, my character. and then just carrying on with Super Mario 3D World, which I've gotten to the end of the story and now doing the bonus levels.
Okay.
I just uploaded today's, and oh my God, there was the level with the moving goalpost.
That level
drives me mad. I was like, guys, look, I'm going to just get the flagpole, then I'll go back and get the stuff. And if I don't do it in the episode, I do it off the screen. It was just like...
I really do like that game. I really do like that level, though, to be fair.
I enjoy some more than others.
Yeah.
That one, not so much. But, trust me, when I get to that very last level, oh, man, that's going to be a headache. It's just going to be a compilation of deaths. Oh dear. And then Super Mario RPG, which I'm progressing through quite nicely. There was a bit with a plant that was really troubling me, and most of the episode was me trying to fight it, and I failed. And what I really needed to do was just equip an accessory to stop me turning into a scarecrow or a mushroom. I was just like, oh.
I mean, it's a game I played a little while ago now when it came out on the virtual console.
Mm.
And my first impression of it was just, it is brutal.
It's
really unforgiving.
It's so hard at some points. And then there's other points where it's just like, nah, it's easy. But it's not something you just go, yeah, it's just run through it, it's easy. It's proper, like, you have to really think about what you're doing. I was like, but there are points where it's funny and the humor is quite unusual. But it's a good game. I'm really enjoying it, especially for such a blind playthrough. I'm doing quite well.
Nice.
Matthew, your turn.
So I've been playing three games these past couple of weeks. So of course, Pokémon Sun, we've already talked about that in good detail. But mm-hmm. I've also been playing Twisted Fusion. And not only have I been playing it, I finally completed it.
Oh. Yes.
So I think what it just required was like a good, just good sitting down for a good while. So I managed to, just this past Wednesday and Thursday, I dedicated a good amount of my evening, both evenings towards that. And I managed to complete it within 7.5 hours. That's how long it took me to beat it.
Alright.
So I do regret not being able to finish it earlier, but nevertheless, because I am reviewing it for VGTribune,
mm-hmm.
and so I am very grateful for Lewis for providing me a copy of the game. So expect a review in the coming days, hopefully.
What did you make of the script? I've got to ask.
I thought it was alright. Like, I think I may have missed some references, I'm not too sure, but sometimes it was quite charming, to be fair. But it was an alright game, especially for the price. It was four quid, was that it?
Yeah, I think it was, is it $5?
Yeah, $5, so, 5 euros or 4 quid. I think that's like a good price for the amount of content that it offers, yeah, but yeah, it's, well, let me just say, like, I'll do my whole thought stuff in the review. Let me just say. I'm sorry, but yeah, it wasn't too bad. I think if you are looking for a good game with a lot on offer, then Twisted Fusion wouldn't be too bad, especially since it's 4 quid. So yeah, but definitely check out Twisted Fusion for yourself for reviews. My one should be coming within the coming days. It may have already been out, depending on when this podcast is out. Who knows? But finally, my last one being Picross 3D Round 2 demo. I don't know why I said Round 3 in the Google Docs. That better not be Sam playing around yet again.
I touched nothing, thank
you.
Oh,
so why is my name now in pink and italics and a different font?
It's quite charming.
That's charming.
It brings out Matt's feminine side.
Oi! How are you? I'm not Brionne,
alright? Never been
right?
In touch with your feminine side.
I'm not Brionne. God.
I don't know. I reckon Dartrix is in touch with his feminine side.
Well, probably not. Yeah. He's like,
he likes brushing his hair a lot. See, look, Matt is secretly a Dartrix.
No, but Dartrixes are actually cool. So
yeah.
Be quiet.
They're similar to you. They like to swish their hair.
Just be quiet. Picross round. Picross 3D round 2. There we go. Do not make it bigger, Sam. Come on. I can't, I can't be bothered to change it.
So
I think I have said on the show that I do quite like Procross, and even just saying I just like it is a bit of an understatement. Pokemon Picross, I think I am considering just investing in the whole thing. I still have to get around to finishing that. I got this Zelda Twilight Princess themed one on my Nintendo Goodwill early on in the year. And I swear there was another Picross game I was going to get. But yeah, I do really like Picross. It's really fun. And Picross 3D Round 2, I haven't played Picross 3D before, but with the demo of Picross 3D Round 2, it just explains everything so well. It does look a bit complicated when you see videos of it, but it just explains everything just so well. It really does.
So I've never actually played a Picross game before, which is probably terrible. But
it's alright. But
in terms of coming to the game, this might be an odd question, but how much time would you say you did in kind of each sitting on the game? Is it something that you can just pick up and play for kind of 15 minutes? Or is it something you've got to invest time in?
I'd say so. Bear in mind, this is only the demo. I have yet to get the full product, but take Pokemon Picross. I'd say that would work well as like 15 minutes sessions, because that's how long it takes once you get the hang of it, I'd say. So Picross 3D does vary slightly. Not only are there just like 3D puzzles, so now you also have like slices, so you have to go into the depths of the puzzle just to, in order to solve it, but it just like works differently from Picross, but it still works very simply. I feel like it's hard to explain, and if you've listened to the show before, you probably know how shit I am at explaining stuff, but oh well.
but I guess pick up the demo if you're not sure.
Yeah, definitely. If not, if you want to have a go at normal Picross, then pick up Pokemon Picross. It's free, so there we go. But Picross 3D is still really good. If you like Picross, then you like Picross 3D, I think, and I am planning on getting the full game for Christmas. So that's that. Any final games? Oh! Well, I just want to say that I've been watching the Pokémon Sun and Moon anime as well, and I'm quite enjoying it, actually.
I've watched the first two episodes. That's about it.
I would say I'm quite enjoying it. It's just, like, very, like, chilled, laid back.
I found it a bit cheesy where, like, how Ash learned the Z move.
Yeah, that was, like, very... Ooh.
I was like, really? Like, you got that from, like, a verbal-less Pokemon?
That doesn't make sense. Oh dear. I think they just, like... The one problem that I did find within, like, the first two episodes is that they just throw so much at you. It feels like an advertisement for Sun and Moon. That's what it feels like, really. But I found the opening to be incredibly catchy. It's just another thing to say. But yeah, I am liking it. I think I still need to catch up. Well, not even catch up, just watch X, Y, and Z. Because apparently that was really good. So
yeah, it gets quite dark at the end. Yeah,
apparently. Or it's like more like action-based or something like that.
I'm going through that at the moment, and I'm sort of just about to... I think tomorrow's episode I'm going to watch is the final of the Kalos League.
All right.
So, but I know that there is quite a bit of kind of post that with the kind of Team Flare stuff going on. But it has been a really good series, and it's really the first one I've kind of watched rigorously for a little while in terms of the Pokemon anime.
All right.
So, yeah, I've enjoyed that. But then, again, on the flip side, I have enjoyed Sun and Moon too.
Alright, nice. Although, unfortunately,
but yeah, very different experiences.
Kiss anime isn't loading right now for some odd reason. So I'm very, very sad about that.
Aww.
Don't... yeah, just shut up, alright? I like my anime.
So do I? Oh, God. Anyway, is there anything else we want to cover, or is that all the games we've been playing?
No, that I think that wraps up for this section, so let's head towards our final section. So this is our final section of the podcast now, which is also our shout out section. And just final section. This week we have a listener question, and it comes from Darren Jex. Sorry if I mispronounced your name, but he's from the Mario Kart UK community as well as Street Pass North Wales. And he asks, do you think the Switch would be better without the screen? Realistically, the screen isn't necessary. I don't think I'd ever take the Switch out and about, even though I always take my 3DS out. They could release a screenless version later on, for example, say for cheaper. And before you say there wouldn't be a Switch, how about a 3DS without 3D? Ha. Sorry,
First of all, thank you for the question. That's probably the first thing we should say.
I don't think... Without the screen, the Switch loses its actual purpose. Like, Nintendo could very easily just put down just a traditional console, but the fact that it's... You could take it with you on the go, lose all these things with it, that's its marketing point.
For me, I think it's more like the whole point is that it's the integration of a home console and an on-the-go console. So if you take away that screen element, it kind of defeats the purpose of this whole integration purpose.
Well, it's just now you just like got just another generic console competing against PlayStation and Xbox. You're not going to have anything that differentiates.
Yeah, the only other thing it'd have going for it is the NVIDIA graphics system. Yeah. But that would be about it. So, I don't...
Well, the thing is that, like, the screen is the actual console, isn't it?
Yeah, exactly.
So, like, if you had the screen, then you just have, like, just nothing.
It's just a block.
Although I do see, like, of course, well, I'm just, like, being just a really nitty brat. Of course, it is a home console. But it's just, if you take away that... I think what he mentions here, that I think they could do well by releasing a screenless version, just creating like a more traditional home console. I think they could do well with that, because after all, the 2DS, I think that has done moderately well, and that's like certainly downgraded version of the 3DS. Although I would say upscaled, because like it just feels better, I'd say, because the original 3DS just seems really like uncomfortable to use. Looking back at it, and 2DS is ultimately cheaper as well, for a brand new one at least. So I do see that point, but with the 3DS, that's just like one graphical thing. That's not like something that's like a whole gameplay changer, like being able to play Zelda Breath of the Wild, or Skyrim, or even Dark Souls. That's another remade game. That's like, you'll be able to play that on the go, and that's simply nothing... That's simply something PS4 or Xbox One can't do. If you remove that, then you just have just a generic console. And I don't... And that's... That won't do as selling. Like, it may be alright with them just, like, bad graphics and, of course, like, their games. Their games will be amazing no matter what, you know. Because you're getting Breath of the Wild, Splatoon, Mario Kart, you know, all those big hitters. But I just don't think it would be very Nintendo if they didn't do something unique.
Thing is, Nintendo is trying to be more about doing something different.
Yeah.
And straying away from the generic, this is a home console sort of thing.
And I think we still need that kind of viewpoint in the industry. Personally.
I do agree with a few things he's saying, actually. Personally, I don't think I would really want to take the Switch screen out and about, just from the kind of first impression of it. I don't think it's something I would want to take out and about too much, and because it is such an... And like you said, if it is the console, if you stick that in your bag and it gets crushed by something, there's a lot riding on it.
I think they'd likely be releasing cases.
I would hope they bring out cases, or at least provide it with a case, because the whole point of it is that it's supposed to take it out and about. Like, I would hope, like, after the whole Wiimote, you know, accident with the straps thing, they'd sort of think, perhaps it would be safe and have something protective, and, you know, so that it doesn't break, because I can see that happening in an instant.
Having said that, I definitely would, although I might not be too confident taking it out and about, it's something I'd like bring upstairs or have on the sofa if the missus is watching something on telly.
On the toilet, and probably.
Yeah, exactly.
That's the one everyone thinks about. Like, that's the one everyone says.
although I kind of see it as a bit of an evolution of the gamepad in that respect, because I think when the gamepad kind of first hit, or we heard about the gamepad, people's imaginations were kind of running wild and assuming that we would be able to really just kind of have that.
And you could only take it like a good 10 feet away from the console or something, can't you?
Yeah, but in reality, it hasn't really met up with that. So I see the Switch as kind of fulfilling what we really wanted from the gamepad.
I think the difference is about the gamepad and the Switch, though, is that Switch, that's just a one screen console, whereas the gamepad, that's a second screen. Granted, that didn't take as much use as I think it did, although some games did use it to good effect, like the Zelda HD remasters of both Wind Waker and Twilight Princess. I think they made good use of providing a map for the player and all those sort of things. Same with Tokyo and Raj Session Sharp FE, it provided like a list of like enemy stats as well as your own stats. So I think that was a good thing about the game. And of course, like, the two best uses, I think, well, three, were probably Nintendo Land for asymmetrical gameplay, Super Mario Maker for its level designer, and for me personally, Splatoon. Because you use a gyro, you've got the Amiibo support in there, and just having that second screen, not only could you view the progress of the match, but you could also just tap simply to a teammate and jump to their locations, which is something that they may encounter trouble with when having
the Switch version.
Yeah.
So, and that's, so do you think the gameplay will suffer?
It could be, because like that's one of the things that I really
I hope not.
I hope I could think of some ways around it. Like, they could just have like a map on like on the edge of a screen, on the corner of the screen. And to jump to another teammate, maybe if you just press a button and then, because the D-pad, that would be used to like share messages, wouldn't there? And I hope that they get more messages. But maybe when you hold down a certain trigger, now you have the option to jump between one of your teammates, which may not be useful if all of your teammates are Japanese, which is what I often encountered. But just like being able to just see, just hold down the trigger, and then seeing each of those teammates highlighted with the name above them on that little map. And then you could jump to them that way. I think that's a good getaway, but I think the gamepad definitely provided some unique gameplay experiences, and that's why I'll always remember it fondly, albeit a bit trash because it's not graphically powerful. Where the Switch, you can take it on the go. It's not really a secondary screen, but you can take it on the go in the HD, no less. And personally, I think I would like that better, you know. So I'm not too bothered. I feel like I went on like a little bit too long. I'm sorry if I have.
No, it's the point. We're supposed to be answering these questions that we rarely get.
Yeah.
You got to jump on it.
Just to go back to the original question, I don't think it would be better with the screen. Like, I think you're kind of half right and half wrong about the screen not being necessary, as it is just a thing, but it would definitely not be better without the screen. You know, like, even if you're not planning on taking it out and about, you must certainly appreciate the gesture that you can do so, you know.
Yeah, I think ultimately this is an attempt by Nintendo to combine two markets.
Yeah.
So you, by doing a non-screened version, you'll just be dividing it again.
Yeah. And you'll just be creating, like, just a generic console, and that's just something that isn't really Nintendo. Well, in this day and age, because like even I'd say the GameCube is kind of generic, whereas the Wii, that was doing something new, and even the Wii U to some extent. So it's good to see that the Switch has like developed on Nintendo's idea of like always bringing like a new innovation to the gaming market, you know.
And I think actually, out of the last few generations of consoles, this is the kind of one that looked the most sleek and gamery and less kind of gimmicky than all of them.
And I think that was like evident from the reveal trailer, because it just seemed... at the end, of course, there was like the big Splatoon tournament. I think that was really cool to see. But just throughout the trailer, you just see just normal people just playing it. Which is a horrible way of putting it around, because it's just sounding like I'm not a normal person.
Well.
it's a terrible way of phrasing it, but just like the general consumer, I'd say. Like maybe even someone that's not really too into games like we are. Which again is like a bit arrogant of ourselves, or myself rather, but... You know, whereas us, we're very passionate about our games. You know, we always know what's happening on the industry. But general consumers, which I think were shown off in the reveal trailer, or at least that's what Nintendo were trying to get across, it just shows that wide appeal, again, similar to the Wii, where that got a lot of people.
Yeah, I think they've got to be realistic about the market, haven't they? And that... The really hardcore gamers are quite often PC gamers, so that's they're not going to kind of beat them on that sort of battlefield. And then the kind of more general kind of console base, you've got two huge giants slugging it out, and you can't really get back into that market either. So they've got to kind of look for people where they can and pick up the rest.
Yeah, that's... Yeah, I think just that final bit again. I think I wouldn't mind if they released a screenless version, but then again, that just like takes away from the concept altogether, I feel like. Because like even with my 3DS, new 3DS XL, I hardly use the 3D at all. And I'm not really all too bothered, you know. But again, thanks, Darren, for your question. Feel free to just send in, you know, like, it's not like we have an abundance or anything. It's like, we get these, like, once in a blue moon.
If you do have any questions, please send them to the End Podcast System email, or on Facebook or Twitter. We really appreciate it.
Or, you could also join our Discord server.
Yes, indeed.
Which has nobody in it right now, which is very, like, discouraging to me.
It's alright, it's still a starting thing. We'll get there.
Ian, do you have Discord?
To be honest, I've never heard of it.
Oh, really?
Fill me in, guys.
Discord is a program that can be used for just general typing chat, but there's also voice channels. So you can set up different voice channels for chatting, playing games online.
Yeah.
It also has, like... for PC games as well, it's also got integrated overlay software, so it's a really good system.
And how would I go about joining your kind of group in that then?
So first of all, just get a Discord account, just download it to desktop or mobile
the best thing
device
to do.
And then once you're in, and then you just simply click on the link to in our description. On this episode,
it's on our Facebook page as well.
All right. So just click on that link and should be directed to our server, and then just feel free to just talk Nintendo with us. And we also have a server within our server where you can just ask questions for the podcast.
Yeah, so it's a separate text channel. So we have a general one, and then we have one for questions, which is quite handy.
Yep.
Awesome, good to know.
Right.
I think we move on to shoutouts now.
Yeah, so I think we should save yours. No, let's start off with it. So of course, check out Pokémon Voice. They're a great show.
Pokémon Voice?
Yes, Pokémon Voice.
Pokémon Voice, okay. Yes.
Ian, do you want to just explain again what Pokémon Voice is?
So Pokémon Voice is basically myself and Lewis from Nintendo Voice fame talking about all things Pokémon, really. Simple as that. So we've been obviously discussing a lot of Sun and Moon recently, but we also discuss the kind of anime, any films that we've seen, as well as the kind of TCG as well.
Nice.
So yeah, if that any of that sounds interesting to you and my voice hasn't been too offensive, then do check it out. We're on Twitter at Pokémon Voice, and you can obviously get in touch with us as well via email by getting in touch with hello@pokemonvoice.com. Mm.
Sweet.
Yeah. So definitely check out Pokémon Voice. I'm going to give a shout out to DS London this week. They, this episode probably won't be up by the time their event, but they had their, they will have, or depending on when this episode gets up, they will have had their, end of year event, which sadly I probably won't be able to go to.
Because
of these past 2 days I've felt a tad bit ill. I don't want to risk anyone else getting infected. But it's also the fact that I've got a lot of work to be doing. So, of course, editing this podcast, but also just stuff that I need to write for both Nintendo Prime and VGTribune, including Twisted Fusion review. Be on the lookout for that. If it's up already, I'll put it in the description below for you to check out. Or maybe not, I'm not too sure. But we shall see. And those are just like a lot of homework as well that I need to get around to doing. So I hope that DS London, they're just a great bunch of people, like, let me just say, like, they really are. So I'm really gutted that I couldn't make it for the end of the year, but I really hope everyone had like a really good time at the end of year party, and hopefully I could see you guys in the new year.
I'm sure they will. They'll look forward to your return.
Right, Sam, do you want to go with shout-outs?
As always, I will give a lovely shout-out to Street Pass UK. To anybody who doesn't know what Street Pass UK is, it's just a general community where we there's different ones in different places. So check out the Street Pass UK website to look for local events in your area. It's just basically people getting together, playing games. There might be themed ones based on what's coming out. It's just generally about having a good time. All I say is go out there, meet some new people, don't be afraid. It's really general friendly atmosphere, and you get to have a lot of fun. So yeah, definitely go check that out, guys. That's it.
Yep.
Unless we've got any other shout outs.
No, I don't think so. So we're within the final stretch of this episode. Right, so as I believe Sam said before, you can get in contact with us on our Facebook and Twitter, which are NPodcastSystem. Just search for us on Facebook and Twitter. Our email is nintendopodcastsystem@gmail.com. Very sorry for the long name, but that was created within the early days of the podcast. I'm sorry. This podcast is a part... You can find the podcast on YouTube, on VGTribune.com, on iTunes, or on Podomatic. If we ever get a Patreon, it will probably be on SoundCloud too. But don't take that seriously, because Patreon will probably never happen, because it doesn't have a big enough user base. But whatever. But we have the best user base, and that's what it means. As well, and so does Pokémon Voice. Mm-hmm. And Nintendo Voice and all other great podcasts. Like Nintendo Podcast, I don't know why, but may as well just say it, like, just listen to many Nintendo podcasts, why not? Sorry for that bit of an awkward moment there.
It was beautiful.
Oh, cheers, man.
He pulls it off so effortlessly, and you know, it's,
yeah.
No, it's I just sound cringy. Lyrical that's what I end up doing. Nah, but so Ian, where can people find you?
Yep. So again on Twitter, I go by Pokemon A Demo, which is at PKMN A Demo ADEMO. Mm-hmm. Yep. So that's pretty much
okay.
It. Yeah.
Sam, where can people find you?
People can find me at SamSpade_UK on Twitter, as well as at SamSpade Gaming for my YouTube stuff. I am on Facebook as well for SamSpade Gaming, and you'll find my YouTube channel, SamSpade Gaming.
And finally, you can find me on Twitter at Acekibo. I also write for VGTribune.com as well as Nintendo Prime, where I posted my top 5 Nintendo Switch ports. That was my first article. It should be my pinned tweet if you want to have a look. Yes, that's basically where you can find me. Ian, what's our closing music?
Okay, so going for something a bit different here. We've got the Phoenix Wright celebration music. So ooh, picture the scene. You've just beaten Dartrix or Edgeworth in court. And this is the music that we'll be playing during your celebration.
All right.
Also, you can join us, guys, on, as we've discussed earlier, the Discord channel.
Yep.
For a little bonus, if you join soon, you'll be able to catch the awesome artwork I found of Matt's awesome Dartrix.
Well, like, they can just look on it at any time. Like, that's the thing.
Join quickly. They're there. I pinned them. He can't get rid of them. So if you want to see what we've been chuckling about.
Damn, did you pin them?
I'm the only one who could take him down, so he can't do anything about it. So
thanks,
join quickly, guys, because it's funny as anything.
It's not really, but
join for some giggles and fun in chat.
But yeah, like, I would love to get more of you guys on. I was about to say Dartrix, which wouldn't have really made sense. Right. All right. That's another title. That's another title. Getting on Dartrix.
There'll be a specific text channel for it as well now.
What, Dartrix? Dartrix Love?
No, yeah, definitely.
No, don't make that a thing.
I will.
That's stupid. Alright, so you'll be hearing the closing music round about now. But yeah, Ian, it's been great having you on the show. You've been just such a great guest. Really fun to talk to, and hopefully you could come on in the future if it seems good.
Yeah, absolutely. No, yeah, thank you guys so much for having me. Really, really enjoyable and great talking to you guys and kind of broadening out. I'm kind of used to just talking about Pokemon, so it's really nice to be able to get out into the wider world of Nintendo.
Oh, and, I could talk about Pokemon for ages.
Well, we'll have to get you on Pokemon Voice then.
Ooh, lovely. I
think if you had to choose between us three, definitely choose Sam.
don't make me choose.
Oh, no, it's the Sarsa thing all over again. Like, what a great arsehole fire, God.
Well, given that your two avatars, one is wearing red and one is wearing blue, it's quite interesting.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
So you're probably
to be fair,
that, sorry.
I think Jack does have green on his, so that actually does work out quite well.
Brilliant. Yeah, well, I'd love to come back on. And I'd love to have you guys over too.
Yeah, it'd be awesome.
Yeah, again, just check out just another plug to Pokémon Voice. Definitely check out them. Thank you all for listening. Thank you all for listening to the podcast system. I hope you really enjoyed, and happy gaming.
Happy gaming.
I'll be back in just a bit. I just need to get some tissues.
Okay.
And such. Well, I have a cold, all right? Don't think of anything naughty. God.
It's been quite an exciting episode.
All right,
especially with all those Dartrix pictures that are popping up at the bottom. I'm enjoying those.
I'm glad
Edgeworth reference, definitely.
He hasn't noticed. I think he's been up at the top reading the things. He's still like highlighted there.
Yeah.
I think he moved away when you said that, so if he doesn't know, don't say anything.
Yeah.
So I wonder, it's his expressions. This is what I do to him on a constant basis. Last time it was a female Nidoran, it was just like, oh!
Just troll.
It pops up from I think the Game Grumps reference it, and it was just like, it just appears, it just looks like it's going, oh! But yeah, oh god.
I think there's some pretty good Dartrix and Blathers crossovers.
Yeah, that have
seen.
Been.
They're quite fun.
I'm going to find this out.
Yeah, chuck one of those on, for good measure.
Yeah. I do this to him all the time. He hates it. All right, Dartrix and Blathers. Let's see. Oh, yeah, because they both got the green bow tie.
Yeah.
Oh, that's so cute. There's some pictures of like what people thought Rowlet's final form was like, which I'll admit is pretty impressive.
Back.
An over exaggeration of the bow tie. Ah, hello, welcome back.
Discussing fashion.
You didn't realize like I am gonna look over this, see if we'll make good back of the podcast material. Sorry.
It might.
Well, as soon as I was about to leave, I heard you talking about a certain second evolution of grass starter.
Yeah, Ivysaur, yeah.
Okay.
We're also talking about What?
I'm sorry, I'm just out, okay? I see what you have here. Alright, I'm loving that photo of Dartrix as Miles Edgeworth. I'm loving that. But Matt and Dart... Just shut up. Dartrix is the best. There's no denying that.
Oh, Matt, you love to push my point off home.
Oh. How am I anything like Dartrix? Explain.
You love him so much. Well, it's the best.
Dartrix
is awesome.
I'm exaggerating.
Oh my god.